We need to talk about it, don't we?
No, you said
we already talked about it.
Pull.
So we're
off
we're,
of this wiring diagram, yeah. Right here, the fancy yellow.
We're going to
and then we need some kind of adapter, apparently.
We're gonna shoot another video here. So I have to say everybody's names, maybe? You guys want your names done?
Yeah, don't include
first and last name? No last name. First name?
Yeah, you can use my last name, don't use my first name.
Oh yeah. I don't know everybody's first and last name. This is Jessica. And this is Josh.
DiNardo.
Whose grandfather is Joe DiNardo. Which is kind of cool.
He's not an actual actor.
Weather radar.
Mr. Anderson.
So there's no green screen.
AKA Neo. No.
That's how it started back in the Army days.
And Jake. And some of my other students still at lunch. And then we got Jim. And we got Scott in the back. And we got Nick. We got Jeff. You guys have seen these guys in the last two. Well, actually, so here's the deal. We've done two of these. I don't know what you guys are going to see yet. I'm not really happy with the first live video we did. And I'm going to do another one using this camera. We got a whole bunch of cars to work on, and I'm just gonna keep the camera rolling. We'll see how it goes, okay? So what I need from you guys first is grab a scan tool and a low amp probe, or a Varus and a low amp probe. Here, let me get you a key.
Yeah.
You can use box 3, which is one of those down that way. And I'll meet you guys at the truck. Wait, hold on. You're gonna need an adapter.
Yes. You guys are just closing the fuse and all the.
So this adapter we're using, you can purchase these pieces, and I made the rest of this. There's other tools out there. I forget the name of them. Fuse Buddies, maybe they're called. I can't remember exactly. But anyway, we're pulling the fuse out. We're putting this in where that coil fuse is, and then we're going to read our coil current right there.
Yeah, you're jumping it with a fuse still.
Correct. Okay, so a little background for the camera here with this one, guys. We have a misfire on the number 5. We did a cylinder drop test. It's definitely number 5. We did a power balance on the scan tool. It's number 5. We have number 3 and number 5 misfire codes. We have lean conditions. We're focusing on the number 5 because we can feel it. We know it's there. Spark looked good when we looked at our spark waveforms yesterday. We did relative compression, and that looked good. Wait, did we do relative compression
no,
on this one?
We didn't do compression.
We never did.
No.
We did a cranking compression by sound, though, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Do we want to do that first before we do our injector balance?
Probably.
Let's do that. Let's do a relative compression. I was going to say we're going to do an injector balance on this, but let's do relative compression test first. You guys know how to do that. We did that on Jess's car, which is also Jessica.
Yes.
We did hers.
Exact same car.
Same engine, different year, right? Yeah. Let's do our relative compression test on this. I want to see the result of that, then we'll do injector balance.
Okay.
Oh, also, we also sniffed this for a head gasket. Did not find a head gasket failure. We did a smoke test on the intake for a vacuum, our EGR, typical Ford. EGR is leaking, idle air control valve around the breather, around this breather area right here leaks, but that's normal on those. Lots of oil leaks on this system. Anyway, not really sure exactly where our problem's at yet. Relative compression, injector balance in that order. Jeff, you got a question?
Whenever we compression test, don't you want it to be hot?
No, we're just doing a cranking compression, and temperature really isn't super important to me right now, although what we can say is by temperature, this thing misfires worse when it's cold. And as it warmed up yesterday, when we redid our cylinder drop test, number 5 started to contribute. So we have a cold engine misfire, pronounced misfire, which is why we ended up smoke testing the intake, because we were worried about intake gasket. So anyway, I'm not concerned about temperature for this. For the relative compression, let's do that test.
Yeah, it's inside.
Okay, here's, guys, listen, here's the rule I follow on these Fords.
The Ford?
Ford typically doesn't mark them, and that's so annoying. So what I'll do is I'll start the vehicle, and I'll yank the 30 amp fuse out that I think it is. If that's the right one, the vehicle stalls.
There you go.
So you just it's just a quick and dirty, okay. Right? Start it up.
You're gonna learn something today, you ready? You're gonna put the parking brake on.
Oh yes.
You're gonna put it in neutral.
What did he run a car into the wall?
No, he doesn't know how to drive.
Okay, well, rule number one is if he's starting this, nobody should be standing in front of this vehicle.
Well, yeah.
Okay.
I made Evan stop because I was worried he was going to release the clutch on and nail me in the wall. I've driven a lot of 5-speeds. You know?
All right, cool. But, all right, we'll do it. Find that fuse, okay. and then we'll use that one. I mean, that's not foolproof what I'm telling you to do, but you know. Trying to save time and
listen, I screwed up when I was talking to you guys about this. I said Jess's car we did relative compression, and that wasn't you guys. And so I, off camera, they're like, I'm like, I walked back in and I said, what are we doing? And they said, well, we're not sure what we're doing. So they're checking my book for how to do a relative compression test. That's great. I have a video I want you to watch real quick. 10 minutes. Is that cool? It's how to perform a relative compression test with a scope. And let me throw that up there for you guys so you can see.
I remember you telling us about this in class now.
Okay, so the video that I have loaded up on my laptop is how to perform a relative compression test. If you Google search that, you'll find that video. And for you guys, you have a setting of 40 and 20 on your amp probe. What you want to pay attention to is right here, it says 10 MV/A. That's 10, every 10 millivolts is 1 amp. You guys go ahead and watch this. I got it up on the board for you. Nice thing about what we do here video wise is I need you guys to learn this procedure. I got to help 3 other groups. Watch this procedure. I'll come back in and see what you got, okay? You can control it up here. You can hit play and whatever from, we should be able to as long as I have my US. Yeah.
60 amps.
Okay? Yep. Have at it. I'll come back.
Thank God you were not here a second ago with that.
You guys got me a waveform?
No, we're just hooking it up.
Oh, okay. I'll come back.
Okay. Cholo was scared, okay? We had to help.
Well, I said everybody else's name. We didn't get your name yet. This is Evan.
Yeah.
Evan. We don't have to say last names. We got Scott already. Scott, we're working on this Isuzu. So we have this woman who brought this car in found us because of YouTube, right?
Yep.
And she has a no crank situation, and we're going to handle this Isuzu. And she was told it was an anti-theft problem, and some background on this is where is that relay plugged in at? The one that was, oh, there it is. You see this rigged up, or the relay is actually broken, and the vehicle has been able to be started by jumping some terminals, and we're gonna pull that out, get that out of there, and install a used relay that she gave us, and then we're gonna troubleshoot why this thing doesn't crank, okay? So starting point with this, difficult part is these aren't numbered, and this here could be a concern too, that these terminals touching other pins can actually cook computer components, which is not a good thing. Let's pop this out. It would really help me a lot in that we might be able to do it on this design. If we can pop this connector out of this power distribution box, so I know what color wires I'm going to, and we can correspond them to the wiring diagram. I don't know if that'll be possible though. It looks like maybe if you put a pocket screwdriver in this slot and angle it this way, you could pop that whole connector up out of there. If I can see wire colors on that, it's going to be so much better. See what you can do.
Yep.
Can I use a pick too?
Yeah. Yeah, who's working with you? Evan, you working with Scott on this one? I got 4 different cars going right now.
That's
so
I've been,
pick
I've
a group.
Been going with, I've been going with
all right. All right.
Everyone keeps leaving stuff.
You can also follow me around too, and I'll teach you a little bit on every one of them, but you're going to miss some stuff. So.
Okay, now where do we go to now?
First thing is turn that key on and get rid of that freaking alarm clock. And then let's turn our headlights off so we don't kill our battery. Right here. Turn it to your left. There you go. All right. Okay, so we just. we just loaded this up. We didn't put the vehicle in there yet. Oh yeah, we do. 07.
Yeah, just now.
Go to engine. We got K17 in there. All right.
so good with my numbers.
And Ray, you are Amore.
Hi.
You're working with Cager on this one?
Yes.
Okay, good. This is what we talked about this morning. Oh, yes, and then Duran, you working with this with Cager too?
Yeah.
Did I say your name right?
Yeah.
All right, good. All right, so we there's a lot of theory we missed that we're not going to catch on camera, and this is a flex fuel issue. What we have is we have negative fuel trim numbers. And you know what? Let's do this first before we do the reset. Pull up my short-term, long-term fuel trim and my alcohol percentage on the scan tool, and that was under, let's go data display. I'm trying to think where I got that this morning. Was it under, it was one of my data lists that had my alcohol sensor. It said alcohol percentage. See if you can find that. And then also on that data list, if it has our fuel trims too, I would like to see all of those at the same time if possible.
Okay, short and long term?
Short and long term, okay. Yep.
Whoa.
Do that, all right. See if you can find that. I'm gonna check on those guys and come back.
It's a little bit more complex. I'm gonna show that one next.
Okay, the little bit more complex, pause that right there. I was good timing.
This time we're doing relative compression tech.
Okay, so you guys, that's all you need, just that initial first part to do this. All I wanna know is, do my humps on the screen look even and uniform? Okay? To keep the system from starting, we'll do a clear flood crank, which is pedal to the floor. Crank it over. Computer should eliminate injection pulse. If the car happens to start, just don't over rev it, okay? And we'll have to figure out another way to disable this system so it doesn't start. We're relying on starter current, okay?
We need an amp probe. There isn't one in the box over there, I didn't see.
You're working out of the wrong box then. What box are you, what scan tool did you guys grab?
Oh, Nick had it. The one you gave us out of six.
Six?
That was out of six? There should be an amp probe in there unless it's not going to be in the top. Nope.
I don't know where it would be.
It's right there.
Oh, yep, we'll put it over.
Way to go, Mama.
I do that.
Low amps, 40 scale?
Low amp, 20.
20?
Yes. Yeah, we're going to go low amp, 20, and then same setting on the
okay,
tool.
Go back one, we're going to 20.
Okay. Okay, hold on a second, time out. When we did our relative compression on Jess's car, we ended up using voltage conversions because our amp probe's never designed to read 200 amps. We're actually measuring something that has preset scales we can use now. Ignition coils on this will draw about 10 amps of current. So if we set the amp probe on 20 and the scaling on 20, we should be good to go, okay?
Did you set the amp probe to 20?
And then as far as the time base goes, Jake, maybe 100 milliseconds to start and maybe throw on peak detect. And this thing sounds like crap. I heard it inside. It's horrible sounding. It sounds like a, I don't know.
Ford.
All right, I'll come back. I want to see that waveform. Oh, wait. Remember when we did our scope stuff, I told you guys, in general, I want to see detail and repetition. So on the Varus, we have to save it for detail, and then we can zoom out for our repetition. Get me one coil firing pattern on the screen in detail, freeze the buffer, zoom out, and then we'll look at the whole thing. That's how I want it done. Is this thing not, wait, hold on.
It'll go down, but it won't come up.
It's not cooperating?
Yeah.
Jeff, you mind being on camera? You
not
sure?
Enough.
All right, Jeff's helping us on this one then too. We got four different groups going, and all right, this isn't completely necessary that we look at the wires. Let's do this a different way, okay?
Okay.
And let's look at the wiring diagram real quick. Where's it at? Now this is going to be a little bit difficult because we can't get into the internals to know what wires what. I would love to know my wire color, and unfortunately I don't. So we have to look at the diagram and follow powers, follow grounds, if that makes sense. Looking at the coil, knowing a coil of wire needs what to work.
Power.
And
ground.
That's right. One side's going to be power, one side's ground. If we look at the blue wire, we see that it comes to a ground if it is a non-anti-theft system, right? If it is an anti-theft system, if it is an anti-theft, it goes to an anti-theft module. So what we can say by that is the anti-theft module would be controlling the ground of this relay if it has one, okay? That means that this side should be a power. Where's the power come from? White, blue, follow it through the park neutral switch, through the starter relay fuse to the ignition switch. So when we crank this, and only when we're cranking it, we'll send power this way, over here, and up to here. Let's stop right there. Get a test light, go to battery ground, crank this thing over, hold it in the crank position, and one of these wires, one of those pins, should only light the test light when we're cranking. And when we let off of crank, the test light should go out. Does that make sense? Questions on that? Will we have some other feeds that come into here? If you look at it, this circuit right here, where does this go? Right to the battery. If you look at this one, you see the white black? Follow this with me for a second. Where does this go? Up to here and down to the battery. So is the white black, it's gonna be hot all the time. That's two that we should have. One should be hot all the time, and one should be hot when you're cranking. I want those two done. Now, which pin's what? Look at the layout of this relay. It's a goofy relay. I've never seen one like that. I don't know where to tell you to go. What's load, what's control? There's no picture on this thing either. So one at a time, you're going to touch the female terminals in the connector. One should be hot all the time, and one should be hot cranking. Tell me what you guys got.
Got it.
All right, so you only have one that's hot all the time. Let off the crank and check them all again, or check that one that was hot. And it's dim too. Is this battery dead? Turn your headlights on for me for a second. Yeah, we need a battery charger on this too. Before we go any further, actually, do me a favor. Give me a battery voltage reading. You got your voltmeter? Give me a voltage reading. These lights look dim. I think we need a charger. What's up, man?
Oh, we were admiring the home done wiring.
The home done wiring?
Yeah.
Do you got me a waveform? Nice.
Now, we haven't zoomed out yet, but I figured that's, you wanted to see that, then we would do the zoom. Cholo's lead man right now. We take turns.
Let's see if we can get this. Perfect. Hold it right there, although we got a little glare from the light right there. Perfect, okay. So the first, this is good, that's a good capture. And then what you would do, you froze that, right? Then you hit this button and we'll zoom out on that buffer. And then what we wanna do is zoom in at different levels and look at them. And I see a problem already. Some perspective here, this is a V8 engine, and they multi-strike fire the coils at low speed. So the reason we see groups of three ramps instead of one is each coil is firing three times. And so what we're looking at is all eight on the screen, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now we don't know which one's which, but we do definitely see all eight. I don't like, and you guys saw it, I don't like that one. Let's look at the one before it. Look at the one before it. It's a little touchy with my finger here, right? So we see a nice ramp. We have some turn-on oscillations, and there's some characteristics we really haven't gone over. We haven't done ignitions yet, but we did do counter electromotive force, and that should make sense. We have a ramp right there, right? The reason the oscillation is there is there's a secondary winding that also gets affected by this initial magnetic field that's being turned on in the primary. Now, if we go over to this guy, you'll notice that maybe, maybe not. Let's get back out. That's the one I want to look at. You'll notice that the ramps look different.
More ramps.
And what that typically is caused by on a Ford like this is a shorted secondary. Not necessarily the coil, but a secondary circuit. Okay, I have a case study somewhere, I have no idea where, between my two channels now, that I show I think it's on actually one of my lecture videos on my premium channel, where I show a spark plug that is broken and shorting out, which would be a shorted secondary. That is either a faulty coil or it is a shorted spark plug. I want to know which one. Let me back up. That's either a shorted secondary winding in that coil, or a shorted spark plug, or a grounded boot, grounding completely. I want to know what cylinder that is. What year is this truck?
2000.
Can you see that one right there? If we count eight, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 is the same one right there. If we zoom in on that, we're gonna see that same pattern. So we don't know what cylinder that is. Were we able to read trouble codes on this? Did it give us codes? All right, so there's a few ways to figure out what cylinder is. Go by trouble code. We can also use something that's called mode 6. So watch here, guys. If we go home, we never even identify the vehicle yet.
No,
we didn't.
Okay, well, we'll just go OBD direct then. Do you have the K20 key in here? No key at all?
No key.
All right, I'll tell you what. I'm gonna have you guys ID this as a Ford. Don't go OBD direct, and I'll come back and show you how to do it.
All right. Okay. We got the trim thing.
Whenever you're done, please.
What's that?
Whenever you are done.
I need to clone myself is what you're saying, right? I'll be right there.
So we can be patient, take your time.
I'll be right there. What's our battery voltage?
11.2.
11.2. Get a battery charger on this. On my desk. All right. So you found our. Let me get a shot of that.
I couldn't tell that was.
All right. So we got short term, long term, good. Do we have our. Where is my alcohol?
Probably down.
At home in my cabinet. No. There it is, right there. All right. So what we want to do is customize this and deselect them all. And then we can select just the ones we want, short term, long term, and then we'll select our fuel alcohol content. And really our main focus is our long terms and our alcohol. And guys, there's a ton of information we talked about on this. I'm not doing it now, but the issue with this car is it has never had E85 fuel put in it. And it's miscalculating the alcohol percentage, and that's why we have negative fuel trim numbers. So go ahead and start that up.
So it's thinking that it has the alcohol that it would run through there, but it would never run through there.
It thinks it has the alcohol in it, and it's altering the fuel curve, and it's causing a rich condition and negative fuel trim numbers. I have two case studies on this that you can watch, but it's on my premium channel. It's Flex Fuel Part 1 and Part 2. You can watch the entire thing, and we'll go through, you know, all of that. And you know, honestly, we went through it together as a class, so you guys don't need to, but Will's not here today. That's unfortunate. I didn't record today, and maybe I should have, but at least he can watch the other two parts and kind of get up to speed on what's going on here. They use what's called there is no fuel sensor in this for alcohol. What'd they call it in the flow chart? You remember the name it was called? Virtual. It was a virtual alcohol sensor, and they use an algorithm and look at fuel trims on startup after you put at least 2 liters of fuel in. It's a big complicated description on it. The issue with this is it's miscalculated. Short trips, driving where you're not using a lot of fuel and you're putting small amounts of fuel in it are a cause, we believe, of this. All we're going to do is reset it. Look at your numbers before, negative 20, negative 19, zeroed out fuel trims. And maybe we should throw the O2s in there so we can make everyone feel comfortable that we're actually running right now in closed loop, that there's not really a problem. We're going rich and lean with our O2s. But our issue with this vehicle is we have P0172 and P0175 fault codes, and there is no fault. You would chase this vehicle for all of your causes of rich conditions until you were blue in the face, and you would not find the problem. It needs this fuel alcohol content reset. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So 60%, we need that to be less than 10. The fuel that she's been using, they've never run E85, that should be less than 10. And once we reset that, our fuel trim numbers should correct. And so that's going to be done. We hit exit. We'll come back to this data list. Which one were you in? Which data list were you in so I know? It was under engine data?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. And then we'll go to our functional. And then we'll go to output controls, I believe. And somewhere right here, fuel composition reset. We hit that button, it gives you a warning. We know what we're doing. Here's the warning is this: if you're resetting this, you have to have less than 10% alcohol in the tank when you reset it. If you have more than 10% alcohol, you'll throw the entire algorithm off. So you can't do this reset procedure when there is alcohol in the fuel of more than 10%. If you do have it, you have to drain it out before you can do the reset procedure. So we're everybody comfortable? We can reset this because we know we have less than 10% alcohol in the tank. We'll hit continue. I don't know if it's going to have me shut the vehicle off.
It's looking at you now.
And right here we're saying reset, so hard to see that on the camera. Inactive, and there's our content. And then we hit reset right here, and it just reset to 3. And then I saw 3%. Let's go back to our data, and then back to engine data is where we were, right? The nice thing about this tool and this update is the data list should be still configured. It's not. It should be. You sure it was engine data?
Yeah.
Because these look different to me in their location.
It is all different.
I don't know if it was or not.
You went back one from the engine data.
I don't see the alcohol one in here. It wasn't that one.
Hold on, go back.
Which data list was it under? Fuel trim?
Oh, yeah.
Come on, guys. This data list should be configured from the last time. There it is. That's what I was trying to say. And it, you know, you're filming live, this is the way it goes. It made me look foolish there for a second. All right, notice my alcohol content is now 3. Actually, we'll leave that digital. We'll graph the long term and we'll graph the O2s. Of course, my O2s look fine. There's my short term. And notice we have no fuel trim problem anymore. If this actually, you can't just hit a button on a scan tool and all of a sudden fix a rich condition.
Yeah.
Typically. What we would have if we thought this was our problem and it wasn't, is these numbers would still be messed up. If anything, my short term would be very, very negative right now, negative 20. Let's say, for example, we reset the fuel trim and didn't fix the rich condition, these short terms would be negative 20 until the long terms were able to come back and relearn it. That is a fix for his vehicle. Again, this is a vehicle, this is the same guy, this is the guy I work with, JR from Diesel. So when you guys are watching this later and you wanna watch those other two, it was, I looked at the dates on that video, it was 12, it was December of last year. It took 1 year for this thing to get all tweaked again, and
very simple fix though.
This is a very simple fix as long as you're aware of this variable. And I believe some of the later ones they fixed this issue with some type of, you know, reflash or something, but that's pretty much it for the fuel trim problem. Alright, we're not done with this vehicle. So we have he's also complaining about a service, not the tire. He knows he's got a bad tire sensor, but he's got a rod control system. So we're gonna go out of the engine system now. I'm gonna need help with this because I'm not familiar with this system. Or electronic suspension control. I want you guys to read fault codes on that and then see what data you can find, like flow charts, wiring diagrams, bulletins. Help me out so I can help these other groups. Ricky, you want to be on camera? Huh? Ricky is a New Orleans Saints fan here in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. What is up with that? Can I put this on YouTube too? I'll make you famous. Huh?
Good.
Okay, I will.
Good.
All right. New Orleans Saints. Derek.
What's up?
What's up, man?
Not much.
You want to be on camera?
Sure.
Too bad you're on camera.
I said sure.
Okay, good. I'm going to post it too.
All right.
Derek and Ricky, they're in my class last term, so, you know, they miss me. And they're just, wait, what are you doing in this shot without safety glasses on? Huh? Okay. Go get some glasses on or go back to your class.
I'm gonna take a video of Anderson's truck bed. That's what work looks like.
It's real clean.
Let me tell you, if you put a straw bale back here, that's gonna fall through the bed.
No, it won't.
I put money on it.
Ford's not how to do work.
All right, so we're back on the Ford van truck with a misfire.
They're all the same.
And you ID'd the vehicle, and of course, we get the OBD2 system checks in complete, which means the garage owner that brought me this cleared the fault codes before he brought it here. Which sucks because I wanted to show you guys mode 6, where what we can use for misfire monitor. Remember we did that in class with that high school group to know what cylinder that was. So trouble code isn't going to help us. I doubt it will be here, but where we go to get that mode 6 data is generic functions and then this $06 mode 6. And then remember this number, it's 53. Test ID 53 is the Ford misfire. There is ways you can look up that coding on demand.
Okay.
And then what we want to look at is our cylinders 1 through 8 and look at the value, and they're all zeros. But we have a dead misfire. All right, so good example of why we need multiple ways to find what cylinder's misfiring. You'd be surprised the comments that you hear when you're doing a misfire on a Ford, and people are like, you should have just checked mode 6, or you should have just checked trouble codes. That would have been a lot easier than your fancy equipment to find. Well, okay. Mr. Check the codes, do the...
So we can do like you did last time. I can't remember what the keyword is, but anyway.
Sync. Yep.
Yeah, the sync. Would pick one we know, go after that, and go from there.
That's exactly right.
Off the firing order.
Like on the Blazer.
On the Expedition, I showed you the video.
Parade thing, right? You know what we did last time?
Well, what did we do on the Blazer?
Parade. Nice Blazer. We did that, but we used a parade view so we could see. I think it was a firing order too, so we'll know.
I want to talk with you guys.
But yeah, but we got to do, that's what we did. We changed the spark plug wires.
But it was, it come down? I don't know, it pulls everything else down with it. I think that's what we're
talking about. Okay. Just so everyone else is watching this too, to get a familiarity of what we're doing, if you watch the Ford Expedition video I have where we had that bad coil and bad computer, I showed and talked about, you know, really what we're going to be doing here. This is exactly what you were just talking about, syncing another coil on the voltage side, primary voltage side, and syncing this pattern so we know which cylinder that is, right? That is one way we can do this.
We need the SA thing?
No. We just need the yellow and black test leads and one T-pin, and we need to know the firing order and which coil is what under the hood. And we pick an easy one. Wait, don't go anywhere yet. We pick an easy one to go to. There's another way to do this, and hit back on this. And what we want to look for is to see if there's a power balance. You can stay. You were good.
I just want to see it.
Okay. What? Go back again. Back again. Go to functional tests. Look for cylinder contribution.
Wait, hang on. Let me get a charge.
I guess what I'm getting at here, guys, is there are multiple ways to do things. And what I try to do is give you every one that I know. And one, check codes, two, mode 6, 3, cylinder contribution on a Ford is another way that you can maybe identify what cylinder that is, maybe. I haven't found this to be foolproof, but we hit this one, we start the vehicle up, we are in neutral, correct?
Yep.
All right, go ahead. That's okay. Go ahead and start it. Good. And we do have a hose on this, right?
Yeah.
That sounds horrible. Mm-hmm. Just trying to get the glare off of that.
I gotta turn for this up the right way. A work truck.
So what this thing is doing, guys, is it's monitoring the RPM increases and decreases of the cylinders. And as you can see, my cylinder, there's an odd noise. It may be a pulley, accessory belt maybe noise. Anyway, my cylinder contribution test is not helping me either.
What should we see if it, say one was bad?
There we go, number 7. Do you see number 7?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So my guess is potentially we have a number 7 cylinder that's causing our problem. This is unique to Ford. It's a pretty cool test. It's worth looking at. It would be cool if when we do our other check, that when we synchronize this, we find out that is in fact the number 7 coil.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
You want to put firing order?
Firing order, I need cylinder location. So remember Ford's number 1, 2, 3, 4 on one bank, 5, 6, 7, 8 on the other. I believe cylinder 1 is on the passenger side. Check me on that. But I need more important, I need both. Firing order, cylinder location,
1, 3, 7, 2, 6, 5, 4, 8.
Yellow and black
5,
test
4,
leads
8.
And one T-pin.
Wouldn't that be right there, the firing order?
Oh, wait.
It says it right
back here. I didn't even notice that. The firing order is right up top on this, which is actually pretty cool. 1, 3, 7, write that down. 1, 3, 7, 2, 6, 5, 4, 8.
I'm gonna grab this lead.
And I am confident that number 1 is the front passenger side on this Ford. I've done enough of them to know that. Just get your yellow and black test leads and a T-pin.
1, 3, 7, 2, 6, 4, 8.
I'm coming, James. Jim.
6-5.
Where are we at? What are we doing?
Relative
I'm sorry it took me so long to come back.
Oh, it's all good.
This is a little bit difficult sometimes to balance all of this.
There's the image we got right there.
What is that? That's an ugly picture, man.
Yeah.
You got a lot of noise in there. Let me just see your settings here. Yeah, I can't make heads or tails out of it. Did you have peak detect on?
No, we ended up having to turn it off.
Yeah, it was worse with it on. We actually took it off.
I'm thinking we want to filter that. Sometimes a battery charger can interfere too. That is really not a great picture for me. I mean, you kind of can see some consistency in that, but show me where you had your amp probe. Oh, you got this.
On the red wire with the arrow facing away from the battery.
Okay. Yeah, and that goes right down to the starter, so that should be that should be good. And it was closed all the way?
Yeah, it was.
Because that's got to be closed all the way.
Yeah.
And that's on a 40 amp setting?
Yep. Oh no, so who moved it? It was on 40. Unless I just now moved it to 20. But it was on 40.
All right, 40 amp, which is 10, which is 10 millivolts per amp. And then you're on a 2-volt scale. So yeah, it looks like you did this right.
Yeah. Can we
redo it again? Let me set this up. Can you pull that bottom, this piece out? Yeah. Because I get glare from my lights and.
Just so you're gonna have to pull that closer. Because I don't know if it's
already. Oh yeah, here, pull the whole podium. I was taking your waveforms.
I was trying to, but I couldn't figure out how to do it.
Well, we can do that. You saved it though, right? We can pull it off.
Yeah, we already took a screenshot.
Yeah, we can pull it off later.
Yeah, I still gotta get mine. I haven't got any yet.
Are they still on the tool? You've been involved in some of this stuff.
Yeah.
I've been involved, I just never got the shop, so I was just more working.
Well, just make sure you know what group you were working on, because I give you credit for those.
Okay. Thank you.
Go ahead and crank it. You stay right where you're at. Go ahead and crank it.
I'll normally start the first time and then the next time it does it.
Okay. Yeah, hold on. That looks like crap.
That's the best we've got.
Let's try a filter. And go ahead and crank it again. All right. Yeah, that's a horrible waveform, man. I'm not sure really how I'm going to clean that up other than relocating. Let's try the other cable. I want to go on ground. And what we want to do is go around both. And then the arrow is going to be facing toward the battery now. But we need the jaws of this clamp to close all the way. I'm not sure that's even doable. Is it closed?
No.
Half of the battle is that. That might be okay. Let's give that a shot. See if we can get a little bit better patterns from that. Go ahead and hold on. I gotta unfreeze it, that would help. And go ahead, crank it. All right. Yeah, that jaws of that isn't closed. And I'll tell you what, just by the sound of that, we're not going to see anything in this pattern anyway. And what I saw with yours, I really don't want to fight this. I want to move in a different direction.
Okay.
It kind of sucks that I can't get you a clean picture, but compression wise, I think I would go in a different direction, but based on what we have, which is really actually in cylinder pressure waveforms. And let's do some injector balance testing, which was the second one I want to do. If we have to, we'll revisit this. Is there a break master cylinder cap? Did we bump? We must have bumped that. That cap has to be laying down in there, because we had that air tube off and I don't remember that missing.
It's right here.
Okay. All right, so what we want to do.
It's low. I want to let him know.
What we want to do is we want to connect the fuel pressure gauge. There's a service port right here, guys,
find an adapter that threads into that and connect your fuel pressure gauge up to that. It'll be a adapter, an extension piece that has a bleed in it, then your fuel pressure gauge. That's step one. Now get that done, and then we're going to check the flow rate of these front three injectors primarily.
Okay? Which kit is that? This kit?
That would be your main kit. We won't need that secondary kit. We shouldn't need the secondary kit. Open that up and I'll show you real quick, and then I gotta run out and help the next group flip that around. You might want to put that somewhere else because we're gonna need that here. Take this out of the top. Yep. All right. You're going to use this hose.
Okay.
You're going to use this hose. That's the one that goes on the Schrader valve. Okay. And then you'll need that gauge.
Okay.
Okay. Yep. All right. Keep in mind when you thread this onto the fuel rail that there is pressure in that fuel system right now, and you want to do it quickly so you don't get fuel everywhere. Just be careful, okay? Mm-hmm. All right. Scott, you got a battery charger on that?
Finally, yeah.
All right, and we still are missing a power feed. You guys double check that? Can you do that for me?
Yeah.
The cranking test again, we should have one hot all the time and one should be hot when we're cranking.
All right.
You got a, do you have a fault code?
We have a CO.
Which is what?
Left front actuator short to battery.
Okay, and he, make sure we're recording that. Write that down, grab a repair order off Karen, and write this down for JR, because he's gonna wanna know this. I don't know if we'll have time to troubleshoot this whole thing today or not. I use jumper wires when I have to. What are you guys trying to go to?
Over.
The number one? You trying to go to the number one?
Mm-hmm.
You guys realize we don't have to go to the number one.
Oh, you just find a closer wire.
Yeah, just go to this coil right here is closer, which would be my number two. No, I'm sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is cylinder 5.
Mm-hmm.
Use that one.
Okay.
So I understand why you wanted to go to the number one, because I talked about synchronizing it with the number one cylinder. We don't have to go to the number one. Let's use the number 5. That's what you just missed, Mr. Anderson.
Now on here, does it literally go like, you got a coil on plug right here, like 1, 2, 3, 4?
Actually, correction. I'm an idiot. I see it.
Okay.
It actually says number there.
I got that on camera, too.
That's fine. We make mistakes. I'm a rookie.
I didn't know what you were asking anyway, and nobody else does. So, I mean, you corrected yourself before we even knew.
What I was asking was, because on here it just has the coil pack. So yeah. I was like, is it literally going like cylinder 1, 2, 3? And then I noticed there was a little number written.
Yeah, no, and the layout of the diagram, it's actually a good question. The layout of the diagrams are never really necessarily in firing order sequence. They just draw them the way they draw them. So,
well, I was wondering just because we have, I mean, we know the light, red, light, green is the power.
Oh. Are you talking about like the control wires and you're trying to figure out which coil is what by color? Because you can do that too. That's not what you were talking about.
I was just looking on here because I was like, okay, well, the control should be this color then.
Yes.
But they're each almost a little different in color.
Yeah, correct.
So
yeah. So you want to, okay, so no, it's a great question. If we're going to synchronize these coils, we need to know which one the control wire is, which one the feed wire is, and that's exactly right. It would be the ones that are different colors. Every coil shares a feed that's the same color.
Red, light,
the
green.
Control wire is the one we want to go to. Number 5 is the one we want to use,
light, green, yellow.
Mr. Anderson, because it's right here and we can reach it. Make sense? We can also pull the scan tool up and over here if you need room, but let's go to the number 5.
So when we back probe, we always go with control wire. We never back probe the power.
The only reason we were asking that is
that is
the sink.
Because either way, you should, in theory, I would think, see it because it's still being pulled to the ground.
Yeah.
If the power is what's coming through, even though it's away.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. I was trying to set my tripod up and focus. It's a great question because when we're trying to identify a control or synchronize something, yes, we always want to be on the control wire. However, if there's a problem on the control circuit and we're doing something different,
there are times we want to look at the feed. Let's say, for example, we have 0 volts on the control. We may not have power coming in on the feed. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to say we always go to the control, but for this scenario, when we're synchronizing something, yes, we always go to a control circuit.
That's what you're probing.
You guys good for a minute? Can I leave you alone for a minute? Okay. I'm sorry, guys. Where are we at?
We found it.
It's a little dim.
Hold up. All right, talk to me.
I went through and cranked it again.
Come here, I can't hear you.
I went through and cranked it again.
Okay.
And the one that we found that was hot whenever we were cranking it.
Yes.
It was very dim.
Was it? So you did find one that was hot when you were cranking, but it was very dim.
Yep.
And that's not good, right? Okay, can you show me that?
Yeah. Let me know when, bro.
And Scott, can we take that drop light out of there? Because I won't be able to see that test light light. Nice. Will you still be able to see?
Yep.
Okay.
This is hot all the time.
Yeah, I wanted to get a kind of gauge of that light. Move your fingers a little bit. Yeah, there you go. Do you give me the hot all the time one again?
All the time.
Okay, good. And then go to the one that should be hot cranking and crank that.
There you
go. Okay. And let off the crank position. Okay. All right. That's off the crank position now.
Off now.
Okay. You did it a couple times. All right. Go to the crank position for me. It's barely lit. Put it in gear. Let off the crank position. Did you? Are you in neutral or are you in reverse drive? Okay, can you turn the key to the crank position while you're in drive? You can, and that's still glowing, which it really shouldn't be if that's the right wire. We may be getting a back feed from another circuit. That might not be a problem. Here's what I was getting at. That, remember, it goes from the ignition switch through a part neutral switch down to this relay. And what that tells me, if he's in drive and that's still lighting, is that's not the right wire. Because that shouldn't be lit at all right now. You're in low? Crank it? Go back to, yeah, see, we're still glowing. So that might be part of that AC clutch and alternator circuit. Here's the thing. Either way, we're missing that feed when we're cranking, okay? All right, let's go to the diagram.
Do you want the starting?
Yeah, here, see if you guys follow me here. All right. We had a constant power. Where's your pen? We had constant power on this one. I'm pretty sure we can say that that one's good. We have 12 volts there. I mean, we don't know if it's 12, but that test light was lit. And,
yeah.
Okay. That comes from the battery. That's our constant. Now, the one that we were worried about, the one that we were trying to check is this one. When we hit the start, power comes this way, goes through the starter relay fuse, down through the park neutral switch, up to here. That's the one that we assumed was glowing dimly. The reason I'm saying it's not that one is when you put it into gear, which is drive 3, 2, or 1, that should have interrupted the power completely and we shouldn't have had anything there.
So that's just like a key on positive.
I'm not sure what that is, to be honest with you, but I don't think that's our wire. Here's where I want you to go next. I'm concerned about the park neutral switch. We are missing a feed to this. I want to see a 12 volt feed when we're cranking. It's not there. Regardless if that wire, the dim wire, is it or not, it's not there. We need to backtrack. Park neutral switch would be next, but I want to try to make this easier. We need to find this this starter relay fuse, and I want you to put your test light on both sides of that fuse, right, to ground while you are cranking. I want to know what the result is. If it's bright, if it's dim, if it's not there. Make sense?
Yep.
Left foot.
Point
What's up?
How much power you can get out of LS versus the 2J before you put into it.
You guys enjoying my chair?
This needs to go in, yeah.
That's just a drain. That's just a drain. That
doesn't. Do we need to get a gas can?
No. Okay. We're not going to drain it.
Okay, just check.
Just connect to
so
it.
So then we just connect this up. Mm-hmm. This is already connected to the fuel.
Yep. Okay. And when we're done, we'll drain that into an approved gas can. I'm using finger quotes.
Yeah. Right. And I just want to say we looked up a video on how to do this too.
Oh, sweet. You guys are learning. So I do have some injector balance test videos, don't I? Which one did you pull up? See, depending on the design.
You started with the first one with the...
This would be under my plate here. Go under...
Injector balance.
What kind of car is this? Go back a little bit so I can see what car this is, because we might have to alter what I'm showing you here a little bit. Oh yeah, no, this is a 3100 and I can't get to the injectors. Yeah, we're gonna... See, what I did on this one, we're gonna have to alter this a little bit. There's a better one for us to watch, I think, for what we're doing. When I did this one, guys, in the video you guys were watching, I was working with a connector right here, right?
Yeah.
Well, the difference, everything's gonna be the same, but the difference is we're going to plug our tool directly into the injectors one at a time. That's the only alteration from that. Okay. And what we wanna do is we wanna see our initial pressure reading, hit the button, make sure that we're using the same pulse for each one, the same setting on the tool, and we want to watch our pressure drops on each one.
So we're using the
timer tool for that.
Okay.
Yes, 10 millisecond, I like that one. Keep this in mind. Do not do this multiple times without cranking the engine over first, because you'll hydrolock those cylinders.
Yeah.
Okay? Once or twice each, and then if you need to do them again because you didn't do it right, you need to crank it over, run it, get that crap out of there, then you can redo it.
So two times injector started. The next one two times.
You don't need to start. No, I'm saying if you want to do repeat of the same cylinder.
Okay.
Make sense? So if you're doing one particular injector, you only want to do it once or twice.
Okay.
If you feel the need to do it three and four times because you don't like the results you're getting, you need to crank it over first before you do it again. Now, we don't have to crank it at all as we go down the line.
Okay.
We can just cycle the key, get our prime to bring our pressure up, make sure you're starting at the same pressure each time. That's key.
Okay.
You let the truck off?
Good.
Yeah, number 7.
Nice.
But come check out this picture. We're pretty proud.
It was number 7.
Yeah.
Sweet. So the power balance test was accurate.
But we're pretty happy with this. It's not nice in the sense that you get, but pretty gnarly.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I just talked to him. He said whenever you want to get a chance.
What's up, Cap?
Edit that. I'll swear.
I'm not. I'm putting you in it. That's our famous engine teacher. There he goes, walking away.
He makes the room.
He's going to be mad if I put that in there. Are you going to be mad if I put this in there?
Yes.
Damn, you know Cap doesn't use your tool.
He would get mad at me, too.
Nobody will to find this.
All right, turn this light off. Serious glare on.
I don't know, is that...
Here, wait, no, we're all right. I can just reposition.
Like I said, it's not as nice as the ones you make.
Actually, it is nice.
We took a snapshot of that because that is gnarly. But if we go up the firing
order... Damn it. Hold on. Right there at the end of that wall.
What if we go off the...
Wait.
Come on now, man. I got it in my mind.
Wait, go ahead.
Okay, we want the firing order on here?
Yes.
We know this is 5. So, right here is 5.
The green's right. 5.
Yep, so either way you go, 4, 8, 1, 3, 7.
Nice.
And if you go back, then 5, 6, 2, 7.
And 7, if we take our cursor and move onto that, what's my 5, what was the backwards firing order? This is 5, this is what?
6, 2, 7.
7, and that is our guy with the goofy pattern right there. Mm-hmm. Cool. No, that's actually a really good waveform. The only thing that I would have done different is because my coil ramps are less than 10, I would have just simply changed this to a 10 amp so I would have had more detail. But it's a great pattern. There's nothing wrong with that at all. In fact, it's actually excellent. So you said it's not as good as the ones I do. Actually, I disagree. I think it's perfect. You can clearly see the voltage and current patterns corresponding with each other. A little bit of the detail might be missing because, you know, you Pete detected it, so no, we're good. I like it. Nice job. All right, so we're not done, but we at least know what cylinder.
Yeah,
number seven, power balance was cool in indicating that. Let's pull the number seven coil off and pull the spark plug out. I got burned on this before. And wait, what year is this?
2000.
Is this the one that the plugs pull the, is this the engine that the threads pull out when you pull the plug out?
No idea. I'm a Chevy guy.
I think it is. If that plug doesn't feel right, stop, and I'm gonna give it back to Al, the garage owner, and make him do it. Because I'm not, we're not redoing this cylinder head. Okay, seriously, if that plug,
like, what is it, like a helical?
No, in the early years of the 5.4, they didn't put enough threads in the cylinder head, and when you pull the plugs out, it pulls the threads out of the head.
There should be some pretty good resistance, though.
Listen, please.
Okay? I'm hearing you.
I don't want to work on this engine mechanically, okay?
Yeah.
So if it feels wrong at all, just stop, okay? We can do some other checks on that coil, though. I want pull the coil out, and we can look for spark coming out of that coil. If we have good solid spark, you know our RPM drop test with a test light?
Yeah.
If we have good solid spark coming out of that coil, then we have a plug issue inside, right? And the last one I had of these, it smashed the plug from something mechanical in the engine. You know what we should do too before we do anything else? Okay. Just because? Let's do the relative compression test. See if we're missing compression on a cylinder. Just hear me out, because if that plug is smashed, it's because something let go in that cylinder.
Is that in the guided component test?
No.
Was it off the start?
You don't. You guys don't remember how to do it?
Well, I remember.
No. All right. Then back. Do what I just said then, because I don't. We're running out of time. We'll do that later. Pull the number seven coil out. Do the coil test. Tell me if I got good spark on that coil. And if I don't, we're good. Okay. I don't want to touch the plug. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I'm worried about the plug. Pull the coil,
with the test
check
light.
For spark,
with an incandescent
test light, see what kind of spark we have from that coil. If it's non-existent, I'm gonna tell him to put a coil in this and do plugs, and we'll get this thing out of here.
All right.
If I have good spark coming out of that coil, I may want to do a relative compression test before we pull that spark plug out.
Okay, you hear that?
Did you guys follow that? We good? Sorry, I'm a little wishy-washy on my direction, but I don't know, I change my mind all the time.
All right. Cholo.
All right, so back on the trooper here. You guys cranked this thing.
And both sides of the fuse we had.
And this lit up, this lit brightly here and here.
Yep.
All right, now unfortunately, what we need to do is go down to the automatic transmission, and we need to find this switch, and it looks like because they started changing this on me. That is not good at all. See, okay, no, we're still good. All right, see the diagrams that show like a dotted line? That's a partial view. See the dotted line around this? That's a partial view. Engine compartment fuse relay block. I don't trust this diagram. I'm disappointed that I'm seeing this. That is, there's definitely more fuses than that in this engine compartment fuse relay center. This should be a dotted line. I am almost positive that this automatic transmission mode switch is going to have more than two wires on it. And this diagram's lying to me. There should be a dotted line around this. So do me a favor before we go looking for this component. Pull up a transmission wiring diagram. We're going to check this yellow wire going in,
okay,
and we're going to check this red wire coming out in the crank. Does that make sense? We're checking the park neutral.
All right. Do you have a tool slip?
On my desk.
Okay.
All right. Chasing
him now. What's the word, man? What are we doing with this?
Right now, he told us to get the CO5.
Did we find any bulletins or anything like that for this particular fault code?
No, they went on Mitchell and everything.
All right, you went on Mitchell, but we didn't use the scan tool on the troubleshooter like we can.
Oh!
Yeah,
remember the troubleshooter on the scan tool. This is what makes the Snap-on tool so nice. So plug that back in. Make sure your headlights are off. We still needed, guys, listen, the troubleshooter doesn't give us all the information.
Uh-huh.
So you didn't find Duran, you didn't find any bulletins on Mitchell. Okay. So you did. You still did good. All right, good. We still did good, but we can't forget about the troubleshooter and the ability that the scan tool has in giving us direction. We at least have that code written down, correct?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
All right, so what I'll tell JR is if he wants us to look at this suspension system, if we can't get any help, that he's going to have to bring this back because there is no way I can dig into this suspension problem.
Can we just leave it right here for him?
Yes.
Okay.
But there's no way I can dig into this suspension problem fault on this vehicle today with everything else that's going on. No, nobody else will get anything done. Yeah. We'll get it back for that. But I want to know if the troubleshooter has some kind of tip. Like, for example, you know, sometimes you could see like a broken left front wire to such and such component, common problem, and we could do a quick visual. That's what I'm looking for. Okay?
Sounds good.
Hi. We are not getting a pressure reading.
We're getting nothing.
Really?
Yeah. We checked two injectors already.
Yeah. Well, how do you check injectors if you don't have any pressure?
Well, I thought you tested the injector and it created pressure.
No, it drops pressure.
No, it drops pressure.
Oh.
So we're not getting any fuel pressure on the scan tool? I'm sorry.
We forgive you.
Thank you. We're not getting any fuel pressure on the pressure gauge. So it's one of two things. Either we really are low on fuel pressure, or our adapter is not threaded in all the way, and we're not depressing that Schrader valve. And that is plastic. That doesn't feel good at all. Yeah. Not what you guys did, but yeah. I don't think we're actually making contact.
I tightened it all the way down. It didn't seem like it did, but it won't go anymore.
Yeah, you were definitely in there. I mean, could we really be that low? And like, remember we had lean exhaust codes too, right?
So
he drove it in here. There's no way we have 0 pounds of fuel pressure.
I don't think it drove in.
He did. He drove it in. I watched him. He definitely drove it in here, man.
Okay. That's crazy. Now, if it's low fuel pressure, does that just mean it has a bad fuel pump?
Yeah, but, well, bad pump, power issue, you know.
Yep.
Turn the key on. Crank that for me.
Oh, there we go.
Wait, wide open throttle crank?
No, just regular crank. Start it up, let it run. Okay. Shut it off. All right, one of the things that I'll do when I do these types of tests is I will bleed this out, make sure you get something to do that with. And the reason I do that, I want to clear the air out of this line that we're using.
Okay.
And then, yeah, that's fine. There's our approved gas can, which is a pop bottle. No, it's not. It's an approved gas can. Go ahead and start that back up. Hang on. Start that. All right, so all we're doing here is we're gonna purge this air out of the system. We'll get some fuel that comes out. It won't be a lot. This thing doesn't work all that well. And that should be good enough that now we can do our tests, okay? Shut that off and go ahead and do my front three cylinders. In particular, I wanna know if the number 5 is any different than the two next to it. We're not gonna worry about the back, okay? Because I can't get to them. I'm worried about that number 5.
Okay.
And where is our initial pressure?
29.
All right, go ahead and hit the button. What'd it drop to?
19.
Turn the key on. Off and back on.
On, off and on, and start it?
Nope.
All
right, so our prime pressure is a little bit higher this time, right?
Yeah.
Where are we at?
33.
Okay, hit the button.
34, somewhere on there.
33, 34, down to?
22.
Okay.
21.
All right, move to the next injector. Now, if we were to repeat that cylinder again, we would want to crank it. Make sense? Guys?
Yeah.
So we don't want to hydrolog it. So I'm going to stick around with you guys because I'm really curious about this number 5.
Do we still do number 5 too when we do this? Or should we do number 5 last?
No. Let's do it right now. We have one, a comparison cylinder now. And granted, this is a balance test. You're supposed to do them all. But if we have a drastic difference in between the number 5 and the number 6, then we know we have an injector problem. And yeah, we're going to want to recycle that key.
That's not right.
It doesn't matter.
No,
because you have the connector disconnected. It doesn't matter if we reverse polarity it or not. The injector will still fire.
Gotcha. All right, we're at 22.
Now we're back up at 30.
We want to wait. We want to make sure our starting point is the same. Are we at 33 where we were for the last one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's cycle that key one more time, off and back on. You're good. I'm sorry. I mean. Do it again. Off, wait a couple seconds, turn the key back on. That didn't do anything. Start that for me for a second. All right. Turn the key off. Turn the key back on. I want to see a prime here. Okay. There it is. Okay, good. All right, good. Hit it. Nice.
Yeah.
That's freaking sweet. All right, listen. What's cool, guys, is we found our problem with this vehicle.
Nice.
I missed it. Yeah. Well, we'll let you see. You need to see this too, Jeff. I'll go in there and we'll switch places and have you cycle the key or whatever.
Llamas can't comprehend.
We found our problem with this vehicle, but I was not able to show it to you on that secondary ignition waveform. You guys remember I was unplugging an injector and trying to show you a lean misfire, and I was not able to show it. This should have shown me a lean misfire. That is definitely an injector problem.
Cool.
I want you to do the number 4 too. And here's the thing, right? We have to do the back ones.
Yeah, make sure.
Because I don't want to just tell them to put one fuel injector in this if I have multiples that are going on.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yep. Can you do me a favor too and record your starting and ending pressure on every cylinder now? Get a piece of paper and definitely a restricted injector.
Okay.
What's up, dude? You find something?
Yeah.
What do we find?
It's
what we got.
Okay, now it has a DCC.
Is this our code? C0575?
Yes, sir.
And okay, electronic suspension control commands variable levels of pulse width modulated current to each damper in response to rough road or abrupt steering maneuver. Compares each damper's command state with the state of their feedback circuits. Okay, so this is an output code. Oh, we could definitely handle this.
Mm-hmm.
Conditions, okay. So all this really is a testing procedure. It isn't like, what I was hoping for is like a cheat.
Mm-hmm.
Like, hey, you know, these are known for a broken wire in such and such area. That's great. That's what we need to do, but we're not doing that today. We'll tell JR to bring this back next week, and We're gonna need to probably have this thing potentially up in the air so we can get to these things. And what time is it? There's no way we have time today.
1:05.
Yeah, we don't have time today. Make sure we write that code down. But there was no other like tips as far as that goes? Like
that was the only.
Just the code, okay, just the tips list. All right.
I'm sorry.
Next week for this one, okay?
Hurt, sir.
Bring back next week.
Yeah, clear any fault codes that's in the engine management system. Did we set any code? I don't know if we did or not. Clear the codes out of the engine computer.
All right.
Okay. I don't want to clear that suspension code out of there because we might need that in case we lose our paper that we wrote it down on for next week. Scott, where are we at, buddy?
Well, there's 3 different diagrams to choose from. But what I don't, this one looked like closest to what we were looking at.
Yeah.
And I can't find the yellow or the red on this one.
Does it show a transmission mode switch on here? Does that say mode switch? And this is 3598. I don't know if that's going to show up. Probably not. I'm looking for the start circuit. It's parking. It's not even in here. Wait, there's park, drive. It's not even showing you. This is a partial view of this. All right, so that's good to know, though, that this part here, they're not showing the starting circuit in here. But what this tells me, the fact that this is called a mode switch and that this is called a mode switch means that they did in fact screw up on this diagram and didn't put a dotted line on there like they need to. When you find this piece, you will find this. These are together underneath the car. I need to find on this, it'll be where the linkage comes down to the transmission, somewhere in that area. We need to find that, oh, I just wrote over top of it, yellow and red. Yellow is in, red is out. Yellow should be hot cranking, coming in. Red should be hot cranking, coming out.
Now, is that something that we can, if we find a connector, back probe it?
Yes.
See if it's
exactly, yep.
So this thing's thinking that it's in.
It's not thinking anything. It's not an intelligent circuit.
Well, I understand that.
No, I meant that, like,
it's in drive or reverse or something like that, and it won't let it.
That's correct. But remember, the reason I said I wasn't trying to be smart, but this is a non-computer controlled circuit. We know we have an anti-theft module potentially down here, but as far as getting power to this circuit, computer's not involved. So to get power there physically, that switch needs to be either in park or in neutral. We know we're good at the fuse and we're not good here, so we have a problem in between here, if that makes sense. And we're starting here and then we're going here. Make sense?
Yep.
All right, see if you can find that.
You have a seven?
No. Oh, I got it.
Go get one.
What's Cap leave?
What, he's he doesn't look at the video.
Huh.
Can I get a tool slip?
Yeah, they're on my desk.
Unless you happen to have a seven sitting in there.
A seven? What are we doing? Quiet on the
set. Just get the pull out. We got to unbolt this little.
Hey, you're going to give me a hard time. I'm going to put you on camera.
No, it's the bolt that holds on that coil is in a very bad spot for seven.
Gotcha.
So we need a little 7 mil to get in there.
That sucks.
It does, but it is what it is.
Okay. And of course, number seven's going to be, why couldn't it be number five, right? Or number one?
Because we would.
It's got to be one in the back.
If it was that way, everybody'd do it.
Ten.
I got to put here, dude.
All right, so we're getting a tool to get that coil out still. All right.
I really
we have. Oh, by the way, the car inside, you guys would be happy to know, restricted injector on that number five.
Oh.
I should probably get that on here so you guys can see it. I have it on here, but not zoomed in. Let me show it to you. All right, so what'd you find, man?
I crawled under. Yeah. Almost got stuck.
You almost got stuck?
And I see exposed wire, but I can't really get to it.
Yeah.
Like if it was up on a lift, I could probably get to
it. But there is a broken wire?
Yeah.
Can you see what color wire that is? Is it yellow or red?
It's like a grayish, maybe.
Let me see. I'm going to look at the diagram again. That wire actually changes some color. It goes white, red, and then changes to yellow at the connector.
It looks like it's a white and brown or white and black wire.
It might be white, red. Red can, it might be like just weathered, you know? That might be it, man.
I definitely see copper and there's a wire broken.
Okay, can you get to that wire with a test light while I crank it, maybe?
With a test light, yeah.
Okay, let me get you a test light. Now the only problem you're gonna have while you're down there is finding a good ground. Here, wait, let's see if I can help you. Take that part and I'll connect you up to a ground up here. Maybe. Yeah, this should work. Okay. Are you on that circuit? Tell me when you're touching that wire and I'll crank it.
I'm on it.
You're on it?
Yep.
Okay, I won't sit inside so I don't crush you. You ready?
Yep. It's lit.
All right, it's lit?
Yep.
And it's off?
Off.
On?
On.
Off?
Off.
Nice. Stay right there.
Off the broken one.
Yeah. Can I show it? Can I show it?
Hi, camera.
Half your side.
Well, we're upside down, but can we
Can we show this? Where's your hand at?
Right here.
No, the other. You're all stuffed under there.
Under the driver's side?
Is the test light visible, like, by your face?
Yeah, like right above there. My head, probably.
Let me see if I can get this under there. I might be able to see it. I just want to see your test light. Oh, I'm close. Damn it. This is stupid.
I have my test light right on it, so. I can see my hand on the camera.
Okay, crank it. I don't see it lit.
There it is.
There it is. Crank, go on and off with it. In the start position. Yep. Just keep going. You don't have to turn the key all the way back off. Just go on and off with the crank. Are you like losing contact on that?
I think so.
Hold it in the crank position. Why is that light not lighting? That might be my ground inside, maybe.
It might have moved around too.
Nope, my ground's good, man. You're holding it in the crank position?
Yeah.
That light should be lighting.
I'm on that wire again.
Are we in park?
Yeah.
What the heck, man? No. I saw it was lit. Hang on.
I don't want to.
How about now?
Nope.
Is it lit?
Nope.
All right, well, come out of there. And what we'll need to do tomorrow or Monday is we need to get this thing up in the air, get it up on a rack so we can get to those wires. I'm pretty sure that was it. It might be that since that's a bare wire and you were under there, if it touched anything metal, that we popped that fuse.
Okay.
That starter fuse, where was that at?
It's right inside the kickstand.
Can you double check that for me and tell me if that fuse is blown? Because that may be what happened. The fuse is not blown?
Nope.
Okay. All right, so that's good. But the first time that you checked that though, Scott, you're pretty sure when I cranked it, it lit as soon as I cranked it, yeah. Right? Okay, yeah. Then that.
And whenever we're going on and off, it was going.
Okay, cool. So we definitely have a broken wire to our park neutral switch. That is an easy fix on this vehicle.
I got up in there and where the wires touched, I could pull them apart.
Really? Like more than one, is there multiple wires damaged down there?
I couldn't really tell. I only saw the one that I could like actually pull away from.
Okay, cool. All right, well, we'll fix that. We'll put it up in the air on Monday and we'll fix this one. So that'll be a nice, easy fix for her. All right, back on our injector problem car. Our front three were good, except the middle one, right?
Yes.
Was our pressure drops the same on the outer two? And then
we had 33 to 21.
On which one?
33 to 21,
yep.
And then the middle was 33 to 28.
Nice, that's bad.
And this we one? Had 31 to 20.
31 to 20.
You think it's probably...
So 33 to... So our initial pressure here was different. I'm not going to be... We have to have the same... What was the pressure drop? Is the pressure drop the same?
21.
We went 33 to 21 and we went 31 to 20. So we're 1 PSI off from those two. The back one, so that's your question, is how do we do the back ones? And you guys were watching a video where I showed how to do that, which is great. I don't want to pull the
intake off either. What we can do is we go to the back here. The engine computer is right here, and this black plastic cover.
Yeah.
Watch your shoulder. This black plastic cover comes off.
Just bolt it on.
No, the bolt holds the whole connector on. The black plastic cover actually pops off. And then what we can do is we can find our injector control wires color-wise, like I was showing in that video, and we can control those injectors from there. Unless, now I didn't even look, because I don't think Ford offers it. The scan tool sometimes gives you the ability to fire the injectors from the scan tool.
That's true.
GM's the only one I've seen do that. But here's the thing, this part is so critical. If we're going to do this, do you guys understand? If we jump the wrong wire and we ground it with this timer tool, then we're going to fry this computer circuit. We could potentially fry a computer circuit. It's a major safety issue. But, you know, sometimes you got to do what you got to do. Or we can tell Scott to get us a number 5 injector and then go from there. But, you know, to be honest, this thing, when we first start this, doesn't it sound like it misfires on more than one cylinder? It just did to me. I don't think there's a mode that it gives us that.
Signature test?
No, see, you guys are in the component test. We're not, that's front door stuff. Hit the home tab, scanner. Go exit.
That's right, I forgot we gotta come in here.
And then what we'd be looking for is an injector balance. No.
No.
It doesn't have, I didn't think it did. So the only way we're gonna fire those back injectors is to do exactly what you guys are watching in this video, and that was on a GM 3100 where I was showing how to do that. Safety issues though, I wanna make sure I'm with you guys when we do that.
Well, we just need to get a wiring diagram.
We need a PCM wiring diagram. We need to identify. Here's what we can do for the rest of the day. We won't do the test. Let's get this. See, I don't know if Karen will want it back. It's Friday. We really need this for Monday. Hopefully she'll let us keep the tools. And they'll have, we can ask her. If she wants them back, we'll give them back to her. But we need to get the engine performance diagram and figure out our wire colors, our control wires for our fuel injectors. And then we need to locate them. If we can do that much today, that would be great.
You can ask Karen.
I'll ask Karen. I think it's a good idea. She'll probably yell at me too.
Rather you than me.
You almost there, buddy?
Yeah, I keep saying going too long these days.
Well, what's the word, man?
It's progressively getting this little.
So we couldn't get a ratchet or a socket on that?
Nah, we could. And I was hoping I had a ratchet and wrench, but I go straight from 6 to 8.
What?
In the camera running.
Yeah, bring the camera, we'll ask her.
No way.
Yeah, oh, way.
No, she'll yell at me.
No, she'll yell at us. That's who'll yell at you.
No.
Give us a camera. If I we'll put it,
if I put it, her, she'll be even more mad if you put her on camera.
Well, I'll put her on camera.
No, no, that won't go well.
As soon as we pop this, we'll ground that incandescent test light. Start that project.
Cool.
Everything is rusty as hell.
Yeah. Well, at least we've been able so far to identify what cylinder for sure. You know, get used to those waveforms. When we get to section 22, we'll be talking about those more. And now you guys will have a point of reference to go by. Some people take the approach, well, I'm not gonna teach that yet. We're not doing that in the shop because we haven't talked about it yet. And I do the opposite. If we can do it in the shop, it might not totally make sense yet, but you have a point of reference when we go back inside the classroom, you're gonna have a visual to go by, right? So
we're
cool.
Be doing this for us for our lives anyway.
What's that?
We're be doing it for us for our lives.
Yeah, for sure. Oh, cool. All right. Well, once we get that coil out, then we'll.
Joe, you got to be close, dude.
Figure out where we are with this vehicle. Hey, Jake, you get that out yet?
Yeah.
I was gonna say, man.
45 minutes in by this point.
Yeah, he skipped the 25 to 30 minutes of thread turning.
He needs a taller chair.
And ridicule.
He needs a headset.
Yeah, that was going to be ridicule.
Why don't you just climb up in there?
I was going to say, it's a good thing you're not working flat rate.
Oh.
Actually, better you than me because that is in a horrible location and we didn't have the right, what, swivel socket? We couldn't get on there?
No, there's not enough room.
Oh, come on.
You need a 7mm ratcheting wrench.
7mm swivel socket. Not swivel and socket. Swivel socket. No? Yes?
Like
oh, whatever. You got it out.
You need to just take it in and get a Chevy. Nice. Where's the
puddle of stuff under that tree?
A puddle of what?
It's
leaking fluid. Whatever. But
like
nice job on the trooper, dude.
Thanks.
That's cool.
Fix the sandwich.
Well, we found a problem. We didn't fix it yet. We got a broken wire on the park neutral switch, which is why it won't crank. So, we're winning today.
Did
you ever figure out your...
And the Taurus, we figured out too. It's got restricted injectors.
Did you ever figure out your source of antifreeze smell?
We're just...
No, actually, at this point, I'm not overly concerned. Maybe that Taurus has a little bit of a coolant leak. That's why it smells like that. I'm not sure.
Yeah, because Justin wants to help her bring her Taurus.
No.
Hey, Jeff.
We can't even read mine. That's why.
What are you doing, man? You need batteries in that light. That's what you need. Light's like useless.
Yeah, it's a taller chair.
Yeah, I know.
That's all he needs.
I can't get any light before I get the batteries.
It's about to come out. Now, quick, Jess.
No, man, pull it.
Keep going.
Keep going, man. I'm going to get my hands dirty.
You're on camera. Be like, you're looking how old. What are you looking for? Like a 30 to 40s range?
Oh, I'm not.
Life's kids.
No, I want 30s to 40s.
There, now you guys can see that. See yourselves on camera.
28 to 35.
What's that?
That's my age.
You're looking for a 28 to 35 year old?
Hey, this would be an awesome site, though.
Well, it is kind of worldwide now, so. Yeah, it's not a dating site though.
No.
Yeah.
No, I'm good.
Just have like a weekly feature.
There you go, do a weekly interview. Like, what do you think about ScannerDanner's class?
This one is gonna end up being good. You guys will like it. I think what I should do, just for what you guys said, is have all three of them up there that we've done. Just because, you know, I didn't even think about it for a job interview type situation, mm-hmm. having you guys being like, look, this is what we did. And in my engine performance class, and having video footage that you're actually doing it, you know? Yeah, it'll be cool.
Yeah, it gives you more credibility than saying I do it.
Unless I like do something stupid and, you know, drag my name in the mud, then, you know what I mean? Like, you never name a street off someone while they're still alive, that type of thing.
Oh, yeah.
In case they do something to,
you know?
Oh yeah, you got
what? Joe DiNardo
what?
You
got like five
spark plugs.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. You have all the things.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Awesome.
Yeah, he's got Joe DiNardo way.
That's right. Grandpap's got a street named after him. Make sure he doesn't do anything stupid.
Yeah. On the other side of it, the bolt.
He already had the come out. Got the weather wrong.
No, I thought right he has a crazy grandson.
I'm still in firm belief he did something to shame his family, and that's why he's here. Yeah. Otherwise, he'd make.
I think it involves the car. What happens is that he went to figure out how to defend himself for an accident.
So you're on pulling the injector
out. Otherwise, he'd probably be a meteorologist.
Huh?
Yeah. Said otherwise, he'd probably be a meteorologist.
That's what we wanted to do.
Yeah, that's the coil's
really?
Out. Yeah.
Do you get the bolt out?
Wait, why isn't it? Oh, we didn't turn it on.
All right, so.
All right, Jakey Poo.
We need to
put it back in for right now.
It was only like 6:30.
Oh, no,
do
we ground that.
Do we have an incandescent test light?
I have the coil at least in there. So that one
can we put that coil up in an area where I can see it with the camera?
Here, Cher, get up there.
We'll need someone inside to start this too. I would suggest not holding the coil so you don't get accidentally electrocuted.
Let me bring out my camera too.
Hold on.
World star.
So all I'm doing is just touching it.
Yeah.
Holding it above it.
We want to hold it above it because
the spark
jumps.
We want to see if we have any spark jumping out of there and how far it jumps out of there. Okay? When he cranks that, it will probably You need to put that air intake tube on because the mass airflow sensor is not going to read properly, and then it's going to start stall. That'll work.
Should enough for later.
And what you could do is, as long as that test light's touching that electrode, you could hold the coil with the other hand while he cranks it, so the vibration of it cranking won't drop the coil down. As long as the test light is there, you will not get electrocuted, I promise.
Joel okay? has bad luck, so he's nervous.
So just, I mean, literally hold the test light on that electrode for right now. All right, and then go ahead and start it. All right, wait, you know how to drive a stick, right? We're all standing in front of this vehicle. Okay, all right. Neutral, e-brake on, foot on the brake. Okay, good, good.
Ready?
Yeah. All right, now you can, if you can let go of your left hand and that coil stays there, that would be great. And then slowly, yeah, get your hand out of there. Slowly pull your test light away.
It's
is it gonna fall?
Yeah.
All right, well then put your hand back on it. It's, you'll be fine. Slowly pull your test light away, a little bit at a time. No spark at all. No spark at all from that coil. Let me ask you guys something. Shut that off. No spark from that coil. Do we have to be concerned about the control of the coil primary circuit?
Yes.
And the reason, you said yes, Scott, but I'll give you a mulligan because you weren't here when we,
no.
Well, listen, the reason it's no is we did a current test on this, right? And we had a ramp on that coil. So what's that tell you about the control for the circuit? It's good.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
We have control of this coil. We have ramps. The characteristics of the ramp are wrong. We're done. It needs an ignition coil.
Boom.
Number 7 ignition coil is faulty on this vehicle.
Okay.
Now, should we tell them to put a plug in it too? I would think so.
Why not? Yep.
Number 7 cylinder and number 7 coil, number 7 spark plug. Wouldn't be a bad idea to probably change all the plugs. And the thing about these Fords, when one coil goes, well, they don't necessarily all go at the same time, but these coilover plug systems on these Fords, they pretty much eat coils. I would like, you guys save that waveform, right?
Yeah.
I would like you guys to go back and look at those waveforms in a little bit more detail and tell me if you see any other coil that might not look quite right.
Okay, I think we saw.
Okay, but as far as identification, great job, guys, great job. So this is the conclusion of our day, and I just wanted to get you guys, everybody shot on the camera so you guys could
Hi, Mom.
Show your future future employer, you know, that you guys are part of this.
I'd like to thank the school's lunch for providing such great drinks.
Our guys up front here are swapping pictures of what they took, and everybody's done that too. But I just wanted to say nice job for everyone. We did good on the truck with the misfire. We did good on the Suburban with the fuel trims and the reset. And we did the Trooper with the park neutral switch, although we got to finish that. The Suburban's coming back in so we can check that electronic suspension system next week. This Ford, we identified ejector problems, and all of you guys were involved, and I think it's awesome that that we were able to show that on camera. Hey, what'd you do to your neck, man? You burned your neck on the
job. I don't know what he told you, but he told me his vacuum cleaner got away from him.
He was vacuuming out his parts.
So anyway, I just really appreciate having you guys seriously in this class, and I it's cool that we have a Christmas break coming up, and I have actually, you know, when you're off for a period of time, you got to start all over. I'm actually excited that I get to come back to this group. I mean that. So I mean that. You guys are phenomenal, and this is great. The best thing for us to keep this going is let's keep getting live work in here. Tell your friend, your mom, you know, sister, brother, whatever. Let's get some more cars in here, and this is pretty much how we roll, and it's easy to take these scope pictures up. The first day we did this, now this will be the third one. I don't know which ones we're gonna put on YouTube yet.
All of them.
We should maybe put all of them. The only thing I don't like about the second day was the head cam, and it was all over the place, and today is gonna be awesome, but.
You get to see my stomach on
there. The first one we did where it wasn't really live work, I wanna be clear that
to, you know, your future employers that would potentially be watching this, is that's what we do here, is all a lot of work. And I think, I don't know how many other schools are doing that. It's just, I think the best way to learn, and, you know, when we go over this stuff in class, it really makes it kind of stand out. When we say, hey, when we talk about counter-electromotive force, for example, and coil ramps, and we say, hey, remember that truck we did? And then you're like, oh, yeah, I got it. That first day we did kind of make-believe work, but that was cool too, but that's not the norm. The norm is live work. And again, I want to thank you guys again for a good week.
You're welcome.
Thank you for a good week.
See you guys Monday.
Yay. Love you, Mom.